for the unborn. A Senate resolution to prevent taxpayer funding of abortion falls short. We have the latest from Capitol Hill. Immigration. Testimony from the Homeland Security chief over a contested border protection rule. War in Ukraine. Fighting intensifies amidst international diplomacy and pledges of military aid. We have analysis. And canonization reunion. The Pope Emeritus marks the anniversary of Pope John Paul II's sainthood. On EWTN News Nightly for Thursday, April 28th, 2022. Thank you so much for being with us tonight on this feast of St. Louis de Montfort. I'm Tracy Sable. Democrats on Capitol Hill have blocked a Republican resolution to stop taxpayer dollars to go to clinics that advise women on how to get an abortion. The federal program is known as Title 10. Capitol Hill correspondent Eric Rosales reports.
Republicans were trying to restore the Trump-era policy to prevent clinics that receive federal funds from giving abortion referrals. Now, prior to the vote, Senator Marco Rubio said the Biden administration isn't interested in saving the lives of the unborn.
By reversing this administration's ruling, abortion clinics will once again be excluded from receiving this taxpayer money, and it would put more money towards improving and saving lives instead of ending them.
Other Republicans I spoke with agree that the current administration wants abortion on demand.
I think most people in this country do not want their taxpayer dollars to go to support abortion. It's an emotional issue. I'm pro-life. I know the church's position. So this is an example of how the left is changing the politics of pro-choice, much more radical.
The measure failed 49-49, just one vote shy of passing. Prior to the vote, the White House put out a statement, quote, if Congress were to pass this resolution, the president would veto it. Pro-life lawmakers are praising Catholic Democratic Senator Joe Manchin of West Virginia, who crossed party lines. I caught up with Senator Manchin. He tells me why he voted with Republicans.
Just look at my voting record for the last 42 years. Says it all.
I mean, the bottom line is taxpayer funding should not be used to fund abortions, correct?
No, I've always said that. I've always been in that position.
Senator Manchin did say he's for some exceptions. During the vote, Republican Senators Susan Collins and Lisa Murkowski, who is also Catholic, voted with Democrats. Democratic leadership praised the outcome of the vote. Senator Patty Murray, also a Catholic, tweeted last night, quote, Republicans forced a vote today to reinstate the Title 10 gag rule would make it harder for women, especially those on the tightest budgets, to get birth control and other critical reproductive health care. We've got to protect Title 10. Democrats have failed several times to make abortion on demand the law of the land. Right now, their proposed 2023 budget does not include any pro-life protections. At the Capitol, Eric Rosales, EWTN News Nightly.
Also on Capitol Hill, the U.S. Homeland Security Secretary faced questions about U.S. border security. Congressman Darrell Issa asked the secretary, when is Title 42 going to end?
When is Title 42 going to end?
The Centers for Disease Control and Prevention.
No, just a date. May 23rd?
The CDC said May 23rd.
When we were at the border a week ago, we saw that on your orders from Washington, but I have to presume they were yours, Title 42 has already ended.
Congressman Issa alleged the department has stopped enforcing the rule. Secretary Alejandro Mayorkas denied that claim. A federal judge blocked the Biden administration from ending the policy next month. And joining me now to discuss is Tom Bevan, co-founder and president of Real Clear Politics. Tom, welcome back. Good to see you again. Not only did Secretary Mayorkas talk about Title 42 while testifying, he also mentioned that DHS is creating a disinformation governance board to combat misinformation in the midterm elections. What do you think this signals?
Well, I mean, some people are calling it the Ministry of Truth from Orwell's, 1984. Look, and the person who was just named as the head of that bureau, I guess you call it, is, you know, on record, has tweets about, you know, supporting the Russian dossier from Christopher Steele, approving of the silencing or the censoring of the Hunter Biden laptop story just before the 2020 election. So there are a lot of questions about exactly what this bureau is going to be doing and how it's going to be doing its work. The White House, Jen Psaki said she's in favor of it and doesn't know anyone who wouldn't be in favor of misinformation, stopping misinformation or disinformation. The question is, who gets to decide what is misinformation and disinformation?
Yeah, it's all very curious. President Biden says that he's considering how to move forward with student loan forgiveness. I want to get your thoughts on that. And do you think that we'll see a wide-reaching cancellation of student debt? Your thoughts?
Well, he said today that he was not looking at up to $50,000 per individual, but something less than that. But he admitted that he is, in fact, looking at student debt forgiveness. It is not at all clear, while I think the Biden administration is trying to curry favor with progressives who are very much in favor of this, and also young voters, because the administration's numbers are very, very low with young voters. It's not clear that this is going to be a political winner for Biden or for the Democrats at all. In fact, there could be potential backlash from a lot of folks who either paid off all their debts on their own, worked extra jobs and sacrificed to do that, or people who, took another job and sacrificed to work their way through school without incurring any debts, or just the average American, a truck driver or, some working class individual is going to be taxed and use their tax dollars to pay for the student debt, forgiving the student debt for someone who went to Harvard or Yale Law School. I mean, there are a lot of implications to this that I think are unknown in terms of the political consequences.
Yeah, and a lot of people asking, is this fair? There's a new poll on Real Clear Politics showing that Democrats may be in trouble come November. Talk to us more about that and what you think is behind those numbers.
So we had two polls released today, one from Emerson and one from Susquehanna, showing the generic congressional ballot question. And that is the question that asks, if the election were held today, would you vote for the Republican for Congress or the Democrat? No names attached, just generic Republican or Democrat. Traditionally, this is a number that Democrats do well in and typically lead in, given that it's a national number. But the Emerson poll had the Republicans leading by 6, and the Susquehanna poll had Republicans leading by 10. Those are jaw-dropping numbers in terms of Republicans having that kind of lead at this point in the cycle. It would portend a wipeout of Democrats in November if they can't get those numbers somewhere back to at least even, running even with Republicans in that question. Because, again, it's a national number. And when you think about where this election is going to be decided in swing states like Arizona and Georgia, in swing districts around the country, the numbers for Democrats are almost certainly worse in all of those places. And so it should be, alarm bells should be ringing across the Democratic headquarters in Washington.
And Tom, we have probably about a minute or so left, but real quickly, before I let you go, what else are you following right now?
Well, I mentioned the generic congressional ballot, where obviously the primary season is kicking into gear. On Tuesday in Ohio, there is a Senate primary, particularly on the Republican side, where J.D. Vance, who received Trump's endorsement, is going to and has been leading in the latest polls. We're following that race very, very closely. It's the first of many races in which we will see Trump-backed candidates versus establishment candidates in races around the country, which will, really decide where the Republican Party is headed in terms of the splits that has developed between, the MAGA movement and the Trump-backed piece of the party versus the establishment piece of the party. And we'll get a good indication of that on Tuesday in Ohio.
Okay, we're going to leave it right there. Tom, thanks so much for your time today and your insights. Always appreciate it.
Thanks, Tracy.
Well, $33 billion, that's how much President Joe Biden is asking Congress for to help Ukraine battle back against Russia. As the war rages, it shows no sign of ending anytime soon. The war has now, in fact, entered its third month. White House correspondent Owen Jensen reports.
In a speech this morning, President Joe Biden called his request to Congress critical security, economic, and humanitarian assistance to help Ukraine counter Russia.
Ukrainian bomb experts blow up Russian ammunition. And as the war continues, this video, Russia says, showing missiles attacking Ukrainian military infrastructure, President Joe Biden at the White House tells Americans,
"Now the cost of this fight is not cheap, but caving to aggression is going to be more costly if we allow it to happen."
And he says, "We either back Ukraine
or we stand by as the Russians continue their atrocities and aggression in Ukraine."
The president also announcing a comprehensive proposal to hold Russian oligarchs accountable, writing, "This package of proposals will establish new authorities for the forfeiture of property linked to Russian kleptocracy, allow the government to use the proceeds to support Ukraine, and further strengthen related law enforcement tools." Meanwhile, at the America First Policy Institute, Senator Ted Cruz slams the Biden administration's chaotic pullout from Afghanistan, saying this about America's enemies.
"And sadly, they concluded that President Biden was weak and feckless and ineffective. And a weak president is dangerous."
Separately, the Biden administration releases a report on how the human rights of so-called LGBTQI plus persons is a foreign policy priority. The 134-page report says in part, it is, as President Biden has said, the policy of the United States to pursue an end to violence and discrimination on the basis of sexual orientation, gender identity or expression, or sex characteristics. Also tonight, President Joe Biden said he is considering forgiving some federal student debt, but it won't be the $50,000 some have been demanding. Opponents say it would be forcing others who earn less to flip the bill. At the White House, Owen Jensen, EWTN News Nightly.
Coming up, analyzing the latest developments between Russia and Ukraine as the UN Secretary General continues diplomacy. Plus, a somber day remembering the Holocaust. In Spain, the Archbishop Emeritus of Seville has died. Cardinal Carlos Amigo Vallejo passed away yesterday at the age of 87. He had been in declining health for several months now. Pope Francis has expressed condolences for the death of the cardinal, who was well known for promoting dialogue between Christians, Muslims, and Jews. Israel is marking Holocaust Day. Sirens blared for 2 minutes, calling the entire country to halt at 10 a.m. local time. A ritual of standing still in silence recalled more than 6 million Jews who died during the World War II genocide by Nazi Germany. Israel's prime minister and president were among officials who took part in a wreath-laying ceremony. While China is enforcing new COVID-related restrictions in Beijing, as a precaution, the city of 21 million people has already ordered 3 rounds of mass testing this week. China's capital has also closed all schools, moving students to remote learning. The government hopes to avoid more severe measures that were recently imposed on Shanghai. Russia continues its attacks on Ukraine, now focusing on the country's eastern region. There are reports Russian President Vladimir Putin hopes to score a major win on the battlefield ahead of Victory Day on May 9th. That is the day commemorating Russia's triumph over Germany in World War II. And joining me now is John Elliott, Republican strategist and former National Security Council spokesman under President Donald Trump. John, welcome back. Always great to see you. Let's talk a little bit more about this upcoming holiday, which highlights Russia's military power. Do you think that it may embolden President Putin even more and his attacks on Ukraine?
Absolutely, Tracy, and it's great to be with you as always. What's happening on May 9th is that that's the 77th anniversary of the victory of the Russian forces, or actually Soviet forces, over Germany in World War II. And so what you have now is every year that is a big military parade. They showcase, Putin showcases his military power, Red Square, et cetera, huge parades. And so the fact that Ukraine has gone so poorly under Putin's watch is something that he has to deal with as a matter of preserving his own power in his country, because there's a lot of pressure on him to score points on the battlefield. As you pointed out earlier, we're now going into our third month, or Russia's going to its third month, Putin's going to his third month there in terms of this conflict. And they thought it was going to wrap up in a matter of a couple of days and they were going to be able to take Kiev, install somebody. The opposite's happened. They're getting huge pushback. And so back to May 9th, there's a lot of pressure on Putin to show a big victory. So everyone thinks that now you're going to see a renewed offensive by Russian forces under Putin's direction, where they're going to possibly even take Odessa or have a big push to take Odessa, which would really take away any bridge to the sea of the Ukrainian forces. So they would be essentially a landlocked country, and that would, then Putin could declare victory and go home and call it a day.
Yeah, and also another thing I want to talk about is, you know, of course, Russia recently cut off its natural gas supply to Poland and Bulgaria. They did it yesterday. What more can you tell us about this, John, and the potential consequences of this move?
Well, it's a huge consequence, huge consequences for the world economy, because now what you're taking is you're taking off the field, or you're taking out of the pipeline, essentially, all Russian gas in this case, and then it will go oil as well. And so what that does is, if you take a step back and look at what Biden did early on in his presidency, is he essentially took out the U.S. progress that had been made under Donald Trump, under President Trump, in terms of making Keystone Pipeline, bringing that online, having drilling in our public lands and other BLM lands and others. That was totally taken off the table by President Biden. So now what you're having is you're having all this oil and gas from Russia that's drying up at the direction of Putin yesterday. And so right now we're having to essentially overproduce now and get this out to our friends in Western Europe, in Poland, in Bulgaria, and other places, along with other areas of the world. And there's just not enough supply right now. You're going to see costs go way up for gas and oil, and you're going to see a lot of shortages around the world. And so that is really bad news. And this is something that Putin is playing hardball, and he's doing it ostensibly because of currency issues. But look, he would take any currency right now to sell his gold. So what he's trying to do is he's playing hardball and showing that he can essentially make the rest of the world have to pay a lot more for its energy prices. Meantime, they're working with Iran and helping Iran develop their own oil and gas exporting in general.
Well, John, unfortunately, we're running out of time. Unfortunately, we're running out of time. There's so much more that we can talk about. Hopefully, we'll get you back on for more analysis. But thank you, as always, for your time and for your insights. We always appreciate it.
Thanks, Tracy. Talk to you soon.
Up next, residents of Moscow celebrate a special Easter tradition. Plus, an update on EWTN from Chairman and CEO Michael Warsaw. Well, this is Bright Week for many Orthodox Christians. It is the period after Easter, which for the Orthodox was last Sunday. And in Russia, there is a days-long celebration. The Easter Gift Festival in Moscow features nearly two dozen venues and around 500 newly planted trees. Local media report that the event had been canceled for the past 2 years because of the pandemic. Patriarch Kirill, the head of the Russian Orthodox Church, also took part. Well, this week, EWTN's chairman and CEO Michael Warsaw is in Rome visiting our Vatican Bureau. Mr. Warsaw was one of the speakers at an event last night on how to best spread the gospel in this day and age. He also took part tonight and in an event at North American College in Rome. Joining us now from Rome is Michael Warsaw, Chief Executive Officer of EWTN. Michael, thank you so much for your time. We appreciate it.
Thank you, Tracy. It's great to be with you.
Oh, Michael, can you tell us a little bit more about the event last night? And also, what was your message about how to best spread the gospel today?
The event at the Lateran last night, I think, was really an important event because, first of all, it's one of the first events, certainly the first event I've participated in here in Rome since the pandemic. So for the first time, really, in almost two and a half years that I've been back to Rome. But it gave us an opportunity, I think, to discuss with the community here in Rome and other scholars, ambassadors, a wide range of people. Really, the importance of technology, the importance of using technology in the spread of the gospel. And one of the things that I shared with the audience was really how during the pandemic over these past more than 2 years, EWTN has been able to really reach out around the world to provide people hope, to provide people reassurance, to provide people a connection to the church in a time when people were in so many places prevented from entering church, prevented from being a part of masses and devotions. And that this was a really important moment in the history of EWTN, I think, in the history of, you know, our 40 years of spreading the gospel through media. And so it was wonderful to be able to share that experience with that audience and to talk about the importance of the use of technology and media platforms in the service of the gospel, which is, of course, the mission of EWTN.
Yeah, and it's so very important. I also understand that tonight you're going to be at the North American College in Rome. What more can you tell us about that?
Well, annually, the North American College holds their rector's dinner, which honors typically individuals from the United States who have made some act of service or contribution to the life of the North American College and the education of seminarians here in Rome. It brings together a wide community, especially visitors from America and across the country. And so it's a good opportunity to certainly meet with and talk to other people and to salute those who've made it possible for so many, many years to educate seminarians here in Rome for the service of the church in the United States.
And before I let you go, can you tell us about your visit to Rome, how things have changed from maybe the last time that you were there, and also any new plans in store for the network?
Well, this has been a very good visit because it's, again, the first time that I've been able to be here in Rome in more than 2 years. I've been able to have a number of meetings with the prefects of different dicasteries of the Holy See and to talk about many, many issues that affect the church and certainly affect EWTN's mission and our ability to carry out that mission around the world. So very, very productive and very good experience here. Good to be able to have those conversations again in person. And it's also been gratifying to see people returning to Rome, to see people in St. Peter's Square, to see Catholics really from around the world returning here to the heart of the church. That's a really beautiful thing to see once again after the pandemic and after seeing, you know, St. Peter's and Via Conciliazione empty for so long. That's been gratifying. It's also given me an opportunity, I think, to work on a number of projects specific to EWTN, specific to EWTN News and the platforms that we are operating around the world. Certainly discussions around our new Asimina, our Arabic language news service that we're operating from Erbil in Iraq, as well as a number of other projects that we have in development and things that will, to our EWTN family around the world, they'll be seeing more about in the months and years ahead. So overall, a very important, very productive, and very edifying visit as well.
That's wonderful to hear, and such an exciting time for our network, too. Thank you so much, sir, for your time today. Michael Warsaw, Chairman and CEO of EWTN. Thank you again. And finally tonight, yesterday's canonization anniversary of St. John Paul II reunited two people who worked closely with him. Pope Emeritus Benedict XVI welcomed his predecessor's longtime secretary yesterday. Yesterday, earlier in the day, Cardinal Stanislaw Żywiec celebrated an 8th anniversary Mass at St. John Paul II's tomb. The occasion also marked the Cardinal's own 83rd birthday. Well, we thank you for watching tonight. For the entire EWTN News Nightly team, I'm Tracy Sable. Good night and God bless.